In this course, we are mainly interested in discussing the social consequence of computing. And whenever one speaks about the effects of technology in modern times, we cannot but neglect this very important topic of computer crimes, which is normally labeled as cyber crime in popular media. In today's class, we will see very briefly, in the first part, the historical evolution of computer crimes, motivations, and in the second part, we will exclusively discuss what are the provisions under Indian law to tackle these crimes. Because at the end of the day, this is a subject of legal matter, and we should see what are the provisions available in law to tackle these kind of situations. Robert Morris, who is a very famous cryptographer, the senior Robert Morris, because one more Robert Morris will come later, incidentally was the son of the same Robert Morris. The Robert Morris senior gave three rules of thumb to stay safe from computer crimes. I think they are still relevant and meaningful. The three rules of thumb, according to Robert Morris, for staying safe from computer crimes was: rule number one, don't ever possess a computer. Rule number two, if you have a computer, don't switch it on. And rule number three, don't use the computer. These three thumb rules were set by Robert Morris, I think, because he wanted to say that if you start using computers, then it's inevitable that you fall prey to some mischief or serious crime involving computers. That is, as long as there are computers, there will be crimes done along with the computer resource. Why computer crimes are committed? I don't think that is a question we can answer in this course. Why do people commit crimes? All the psychological and sociological reasons behind this, I think, is outside the purview of this particular course. We shall not go into that. But people do commit crimes. And for people who commit crimes, computers has become the new tool for committing those crimes. And what has happened is, not only computers, but with computers getting networked, not in a local level, but in a global level, the kinds of crimes that can be committed with computers have increased manifold. I think we should make a clear distinction between different classes of computer crimes. Now, there is first class of computer crimes, which are nothing but the manifestation of older crimes in new forms. These kind of crimes were committed earlier, but now they are committed today, but in a new way. For example, credit card fraud. Now, these kind of crimes wherein you go and steal the money which does not belong to you was always there. Earlier they used to enter the bank. Now they enter into your account through computer. The means is different. The crime is same. So major class of computer crimes are these. They are simply older crimes, but they are done in a new way using computer technology. These kind of crimes, I don't think there is need of any further discussion, but to conclude that these are actually crimes. Whether there is an ethical dimension which should be discussed, that I don't think that is necessary. Stealing is stealing. It is wrong. Plain and simple. Whether it is done in a physical world or the cyber, it should not matter. So majority of so-called computer crimes are nothing but old crimes in new form. And that is why in most of the cases, not only laws specific to computers, but law in general which is applicable is also applied in this case. That is, not only under IT Act, but general CRPC and IPC sections are also applied in such crimes. For example, impersonation. Impersonation is an offense. Whether it is you claiming to be some other person and writing the exam, which is crime, or whether you take someone's identity and then get into a server and do some transaction, that is wrong. That is impersonation. Impersonation is wrong. So what I am trying to say is, majority of the crimes you should see as old crimes in new form, and you should tackle it that way. But what becomes interesting is the other classes of crime which have come up basically because of computers. Earlier they didn't exist, now because computer provides such facility, you see that crimes. There are two such crimes which we have to focus. One is virus. Second is denial of service attacks. Both are new class of crimes. Earlier they did not exist. The very concept of virus and associated terminology, Trojan horses, logic bombs, time bombs, and all that. I'm clubbing all them together under the name virus. It's a very new species of crime. Didn't exist earlier. If you want to see the equivalent of virus in the earlier times, nothing was there. Maybe you can talk of biological warfare, wherein an enemy country would launch some kind of deadly virus into the enemy nation and then propagate disease in a very fast rate. But these instances are not recorded in history so much. So virus is a new kind of crime. Virus, when I say all the associated, they are new kinds of computer crimes. They exist only because of technology. Because there is computer where you can write a program which can self-infect itself and can get attached to other computers, propagate rapidly, not only propagate rapidly, but destroy or collect some information in the computers and then conceal the fact that it has come into the system. All these things is made possible because of technology. And therefore, they become new class of crime. And the law enforcement agency and the lawmakers should sit down and make separate new laws on how to treat this. Looking back, the history of virus is always associated with Robert Morris. Robert Morris Jr. here, who was the son of the earlier Robert Morris. The father was a famous cryptographer. The son became notorious for launching the first virus. He didn't do it intentionally. Unintentionally, he wrote a program for demonstration purpose. It was demonstrated in the classroom, but it spread across the campus and it made national news in US. And because of the panic created, the US government passed the first law against these kind of crimes, which is still being used, Computer Fraud Act. This was in 1980s, when US for the first time passed such a law. Now, in fact, Robert Morris now is a professor of computer science in MIT. But his name is always associated with virus. After that, malicious intent, unintentional use, people have created so much virus, worms, Trojan horses, logic bombs and whatnot, release it into the World Wide Web, get it associated into the vulnerabilities of operating system and other application programs, target many systems. This has become a common event now. And there are many companies who are making their business out of giving solutions to this kind of problems. Antivirus solutions. And there is a long rumor that it is actually these companies which are producing new virus. Because they want to keep their market intact. any new technology coming in, including in mobile phones today, vulnerabilities are identified and people always see how to make use of this vulnerability. After the success of this film called War Games, which some of you may have seen, it is an interesting game wherein a teenager, a pre-teenager actually, using the computer in his home, gets the access to the nuclear facility of US, and he thinks he is playing a game and he launches a nuclear attack. And the success of this game, by the time the Cold War had ended and the fight was happening mostly in the technology front, the prospect that a teenager could start a nuclear war sitting at his home created a great sense of panic all over the world, and people began to look at such crimes in a more serious manner, not because there were reported incidents, because the film projected such a possibility. There were such draconian laws which was drafted in most of the countries. Added to it was this fact that there were some very minor incidents reported, of course some major. For example, in Australia, there is a major break-in reported. The person who was indicted for this was Julian Assange, who is now famous for running WikiLeaks. He was booked for computer break-ins. In Europe, in US, in Australia, and in many other places, these people came to be collectively known, unfortunately, as hackers. And all computer crimes were labeled under this common umbrella called hacking, which is very unfortunate. And even today, including in India, whenever people talk about anything related to computer crimes, they use the word hacker. The act is called hacking, which I think is very much wrong. People have tried to make distinction between ethical hacking and non-ethical hacking. People also have tried to make distinctions such as white hat hacker, black hat hacker, grey hat hacker, and all such tongue twisters. But I feel, whatever may be the terms used, hacking is not the right word. For a long time, the person who most of us consider as the true last hacker, Richard M. Stallman, was writing to media companies saying that you do not use the word hacker. They are plain and simple criminals. Why should you use the word hacker? He was writing to the media companies. For some time, I think media started using the term cracker instead of using hacker. But the popular idea still remains. People do talk about such people as hackers, which I think is gross mistake. It is great injustice to the great heritage of hacking community. In fact, even in the textbook, the author says one of the motivation for people who do such kind of crimes is their hacker ethics. For God's sake, hacker ethics is a built-in mechanism into the hacker community, which has been developed over time with the practices of some great programmers. In his very influential book, Hackers, Heroes of Computer Revolution, the author has mentioned six ethics which all hackers believe in. In other contexts, I think I may have discussed this. The hacker ethics includes 1. The belief that all information should be free. 2. Hackers in general mistrust authority and promote decentralization. 3. Hackers do believe that people should always be respected for their skills and not by other bogus criteria like age, qualification, gender, etc. have been very influential in shaping the modern technology. But I don't think just because somebody feels that somebody has breached into their the hacker ethic, they will go and target some computers. Yes, I do agree that there is something called as cyber activism. There is this underground groups. Most importantly, today is anonymous group, Hacker Anonymous. They do target some machines or some website if they feel that there is something wrong which is happening. Yes, that I agree exists. What is called as cyber activism. For example, if Indian government passes some law which some people feel is not right, then collectively they may launch attack into some of the websites of Indian government in a very targeted manner, simply as an activist measure. But that I don't think should be considered as hacking. Hacking in all historic sense is nothing but a clever prank, not meant to hurt anyone. And in one of the original sense, hacking always meant as the most useless thing you can actually do. As we always pointed out, hack value of an activity increases if people feel it is useless. So with all this context, I don't think hacking should be the word used for cyber crimes or computer crimes. We should invent a new word. I think the word criminal is sufficient. Anybody who is committing crime using computers is also a criminal. Just because he is using computers, we need not find a sophisticated word for it. He is a criminal. If it is unintentional, then it is prank. The distinction can always be done. You don't need a separate word to distinguish that. In India, because we are talking about computer crimes, which is especially a legal matter, we should see what is the context of law enforcement in India. In India now, because policing is also a state subject, various states have established separate cells to investigate cyber crimes. In Karnataka too, there is a separate cyber cell which is headquartered in the CID headquarters complex. A separate cyber cell to investigate these crimes. The National Crime Reports Bureau, NCRB, publishes the number of crimes reported under different heads. The latest data is available for 2013. There is a detailed list, you can see that list. According to the list, the highest number of cyber crimes are reported from Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka respectively. 1, 2, 3 positions are Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. Mainly because I think most of the cyber cases involve some kind of financial fraud. And Mumbai being the finance capital of India, most of the cases are reported there. That is why Maharashtra takes the lead, Tamil Nadu second, Bangalore third. Among the major cities, Bangalore holds the title of being a cyber capital. Mainly because more people here are aware of the mechanisms available for them to go out and complain. That may be the reason. But as I have seen, most of the so-called computer crimes reported in India are usually sending unwanted messages through email or sending obscene messages through mobile phones. These are the major cases, defamation and things like that. The actual computer crimes, that is virus and denial of service, both are not reported in that high manner. The financial fraud comes next. I have not seen much cases reported in hardcore computer crimes, that is launching of virus and denial of service attack. Maybe because these are sophisticated crimes. You need real good knowledge of computers to write a really sophisticated virus and then launch it. And these kind of things today are done by crime syndicates, established crime syndicates. They undertake it. So in India, we don't say much of these crimes. Defacement of websites is reported in high numbers, especially government websites. Defacement of that is always there. They are being reported. But I have not seen any serious case of denial of service attack. Because it's again very sophisticated crime. I hope you understand what is denial of service attack. That is, you select some computers which you use as launching vehicles to launch some kind of messages, generate packets, and suffocate the entire network, routers and switches. You send so much information into the network that the entire network gets choked. You are not actually doing anything. You are not accessing any computer, you are not doing anything. But you are choking the network so much so that anybody who wants to access a service using that network will not be able to do it. Because that network is choked. You won't get able. So it's like creating traffic jam so that nobody can move from one place to another. That is what is called a denial of service. You are not targeting someone's machine. You are not breaking into someone's machine, but you are blocking the access. That is there. But I think most of the computer crimes usually are not committed by someone who has special knowledge of computers. These are done by people using some things which we usually call as social engineering. They will send you mail saying that you have won a lottery of so many hundred or thousand dollars or euros, and they want your information so that they can deposit in your account. Or they will give you a call saying that you please give your password, it's very important, there is some security vulnerability, right? Or most of the crimes also happen but because some insiders know about your information and want to take undue advantage of that. Most of the crimes reported are usually done by insiders. Or there may be some reason wherein there are business reasons for people to go and attack the competitor's computer. That may be the reason. Or in some of the serious cases, nations spy against each other to know as much as possible. So they may come and commit some crime. So there are various possibilities why crime may happen here. But there is a big problem with respect to computers, the crimes done with computers. The problem is the jurisdiction. Usually in any activities of crime, the scene where crime has happened, to which jurisdiction it belongs, that particular police will start investigation. But with computer-related crimes, identifying the jurisdiction is the biggest problem. For example, there is a server in India which has got attacked. The attacker is from US, somehow you find out. But he has used a server in Europe to attack your system. Now, whose jurisdiction does it fall? It's a very complicated question to answer. There has been international treaties trying to form a global jurisdiction for computer crimes. Because, see, like it happens in real world, a criminal may conduct a criminal activity here and go and settle down in a country from where we can't bring him back. What to do? So to avoid such things, there has been some attempt to bring in some global consensus regarding this, but I think there is a long way to go regarding this. Here we'll stop this session. The next part of this session, I will exclusively speak on what are the legal provisions available in India to tackle computer-related crimes.